we're so grateful that she's, you know, one of our first members that was a remote member to integrate this e-club. Her mom is a fantastic Rotarian here in San Diego. And yeah, so without a further ado, Amy, take it away.
Okay. Hi, everyone. I see about 8 or 10 people. Mm-hmm. Yep. Nice to see you all, and thank you for this opportunity and the chance to connect from Costa Rica to California. Okay. So basically, I moved to Costa Rica in 2005, so about 12 years ago. At the time, I was living New York City, and I had quite a big transformation. Just a realization about wanting to connect with nature. I changed my diet, started living foods. So I was very connected to homing cycles, arts, and agriculture. So what happened in a short period of time is my internal compass sort of directed me to the tropics, and I was craving tropical and wanting to be in a warmer climate. I basically left the cement jungles of New York City and went to the jungles in Costa Rica. I found a piece of land in the Pacific area of Costa Rica, about 4 hours south of the capital, San Jose. So when I came to Costa Rica, I was basically came to a piece of raw land, and from the get-go, I started planting and built a piece, like, simple thatched roof structure where I lived. For the first 5 years, I was mostly on the land. Did you hear that?
Yes.
What is that?
That was a huge lightning strike. It felt kind of close, but we're just coming off of a big storm. In fact, I live in my home, there's no walls here, and so I've been running around watching water flowing because it's leaking in certain places. It's really kind of a whole nother world out here. We build structures with some screening, but basically no walls. So we really experience nature deeply. So if it's windy or raining, I feel the wind, I can feel some of the moisture from the rain, and that lightning strike itself. Close, but I'm used to it during the rainy season. So basically, I started a lifestyle here that was completely new because I came here and basically kind of started life over stuff like taking baby steps, learning how to plant, learning how to work with the moon cycles, carbon cycles. Mostly focused on planting very simple structures. It was around that time that I had my first interaction with agrochemicals when I noticed that they were spraying along the roadsides where I lived. And so I spoke to the road committee and told them my concerns and gave them some literature, and they did stop spraying about 10 years. But that was my beginning of starting to notice massive amounts of agrochemicals that were being used in Costa Rica. The chemical use, when I say agrochemicals, I'm referring to everything from pesticides to herbicides, including synthetic fertilizers. And during, starting to rain here, can you hear me okay?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes. Okay. So during the 1970s, there was a cotton boom that started in the United States. And the idea was to bring cotton to Central America vegetable pineapples and bananas from Costa Rica is basically a health hazard.
Amy!
Because
Amy.
The chemicals that are being used on these crops are extremely harmful, not only to the workers, but to the consumers, those of us who buy these products. In fact, there are agrochemicals that are prohibited. My screen just turned off.
Okay, is that back?
Yeah.
Is that good? Okay.
Just trying to turn up.
We're just trying to figure out because the audio is not going to the TV, so it's.
I think she keeps moving in and out of the mic.
That are prohibited in the U.S. They're exported to Costa Rica. And guess what? They're used on the pineapples, which are 10% back to the U.S. So there you have it. We, the living in the U.S., are consuming these very, very toxic chemicals via the produce that is being brought back to the U.S. I was recently in San Diego. I was at Costco and I saw this huge bin of conventional Costa Rican pineapples. It's happening with the pineapple dispense that's happening here in Costa Rica now, is that entire communities being affected by it in the form of massive pyramid spraying. There's some communities now, water has because the watersheds have been destroyed by the massive chemical system, you know, going into the water supplies and food supplies. So I almost, at some point, wanted to figure out a way to bring the detention at Costco to be aware on an ethical level of what they're buying, because they're supporting to the detriment of many communities in Costa Rica. So I did do a write-up recently, which I spoke about successful campaign that we had in the municipality where I live to prohibit agrochemical use in public spaces. It's a whole process because chemicals came in the 70s in Costa Rica, so if you imagine, we're going into almost 50 years of heavy, heavy pesticide use. I did mention that Costa Rica is the number one consumer of agrochemicals per capita in the entire country. I know that Costa Rica has such a reputation as being an eco-friendly green country. There's this other reality that's happening at the same time, and perhaps unless you live here, you don't really see it. So what we're finding is that the number one cause of death, you may have read in the article that I wrote, is gastric stomach cancer, which can be correlated with residues in the food supply. So awareness about agrochemicals is there, but it's still very ingrained in the psyche here that is the way we do agriculture. A lot of the wonderful ancestral traditions have been lost. I've spoken to our workers and asked them what it was like when they were young, and a man named Eduardo told me that he remembers when agrochemicals came to Costa Rica and they first began to spray around corn plants, and they were amazed at this miracle solution that killed the weeds, and they didn't have to do work anymore. But they had no idea of the side effects. So what we find here is a lot of people working for small farms are using these agrochemicals without any proper protection. During the height of banana plantations in the 70s up into the 80s, there were men working out in the fields with just shorts and no shirt and a pair of boots, and the flames were spraying through their head. And there was a case of massive stress. buzzword here, it's called agroecology, which means sustainable agriculture, which is incorporating a diverse systems and ways of living in harmony with nature. So things like crop rotation and organic foliar systems, working with the beneficial microorganisms, growing flowers to attract beneficial insects, creating friendly environments. And a lot of the problems I'm mentioning are also happening in the U.S. So, but I feel that Costa Rica is trying to move a fair and conscientious direction. They want to have food sovereignty in this country, and that's going to be impossible. That's going to turn to a focus on small farming. I really think that the future of sustainable food production, and this is even in the U.S., small farm. We have a lot of diverse crops and things. And we know that monocrops actually don't work, right? It's not natural. The diverse array of plants growing in one area to support each other and bring in benefits to pests and so forth and keep everything in balance. So my interest is applying for global grant. I was looking at some of the examples online and trying to find a way to, one of the possibilities is support women in organic farming. I'm just going to mention grant number 1286, which has been fully pledged coming from Turkey. I think this is for 2017-2018. And some of the topics mentioned under finding global grant projects are agriculture opportunities to get training in sustainable farming, growing local economies, supporting education. So one of the possibilities would be to focus on women. It's because overall women do a lot of the growing small family farms to sustain families. So what we want to have is first families feeding themselves with healthy organic food, and then if they have leftover, then they can sell it. Because ultimately we need to feed ourselves first. We need a healthy community to be able to make the right choices to then affect our larger communities at large. So that's one option. I do want to be open to your feedback about applying the different opportunities that there might be for grants for Costa Rica, because I wanted to share one example of a local family that's trying to grow coffee. And I don't know if you've heard of coffee rust. It's a huge problem that's affected coffee crops in Central America. So what happens is on the leaf, there's this, it starts to turn like a rust color. That eventually affects the fruit and the crop as a whole. So there's been this massive spray of chemicals to deal with coffee rust. But there are other methods. And they're using organic compounds in foliar sprays that we've seen farmers doing successfully. The problem is you need the education. And what's happened is traditionally the Ministry of Agriculture of Costa Rica has not really supported farmers here. They've been like out in the countryside. You don't see the Ministry of Agriculture sending representatives out to help and to train in these sustainable methods. So what's happened is the chemical companies have sent representatives to the countryside. And they're the ones that are actually promoting chemical use. So if any of you have, okay, so I just want to get back to this family. did speak to them yesterday, and they basically said, we don't know any other way to do this. This is our family project. Put everything we have into it. They're growing the coffee, harvesting it. They've got their own roaster. They hand-pick the beans. You know, so it's like vintage coffee, except for this one part. That one chemical they're spraying can make the coffee, first of all, non-organic and toxic. And I think most of us, if you buy coffee, unless you're buying organic, we don't really think about what's gone into the growing process of coffee. So coffee is a big crop in Costa Rica. But the majority of coffee growers are spraying some of these very toxic chemicals. So what we need is education and to show them that there are alternatives to the massive use of chemicals for producing food. So that was actually one grant that I found that most closely approximated what possibly done here in Costa Rica. Do you have any questions thus far about anything I've said?
I don't know. Can you hear? Can you hear us if we talk to the table?
Actually, it's hard. It's hard for me to hear.
Yeah, something that I might suggest as you're looking into global grants and different grant opportunities is looking into the vocational training team style grants, because if you're looking for there to be education brought to the community, that's what we did for the Honduras project, and it sounds like it might be well aligned to some of the things that you're looking to do there, finding experts that could come and support in that education effort. So I would just suggest looking a little bit into vocational training team grants.
Great.
I'm looking.
Wait, who was that speaking?
That was Maxie.
That was Maxie.
Hi,
Maxie. Okay.
This is Susan. I'm looking at grant 1286 that you talked about. I noticed that they don't have any documents attached to their grant yet, so it looks like it's not been implemented yet. But they do have a local community core that's helping them with training and facilitating this. Is there any sort of organization locally that you could tap into that could support this effort? Because otherwise you're starting from the ground zero.
Right. So there is an organization here that is a nonprofit. I wouldn't call it like a community core, but they are working on a very minimal amount of funds that's been offering classes in the pueblos on these organic sustainable methods. I've been doing some work with them actually, and I think I may mention the website on Facebook post. I don't know if that would count as a community organization, if it needs to be a Rotary community core group.
I don't know that it would necessarily have to be a Rotary group that you would be working with, but it might help if you documented what they're doing. And then, is there a local Rotary group there other than you're being a member in Rotary? Is there a club on the ground?
Yes, but they're about 4 hours away, so most of the clubs are up north.
Okay. But it would help if you could partner with another local club as well, because there may be some funds available through them. But I would follow this other project and see and continue to be in contact with them and ask them for their documentations, because none of their documents are online. It doesn't really show you how they're pulling their project together.
So when it said that they were fully pledged, does that mean they had enough Rotary?
Yes, they had funds. If you go to the website and look at their project, their tabs, it shows you their financing and who's partnering with them, but there are no documents attached. So you could email the guy in Fort Collins after work, or the one in the contact in the district, 2430. They have email addresses there. Just email them and ask them to keep you posted on the project and send you documents so you can see what they put together for their grant.
That would be great. Thank you.
Sure.
For that suggestion.
Hi, Amy, it's Maureen. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I'm going to put my ear close to that.
Okay. Okay, so a community-based organization is what you need. So the organization that you mentioned sounds like it would fit that qualification. So I would research them and, you know, see how much they're interested in your project. As well, it's going to be very important to have a local Rotary somewhere in Costa Rica. So, I don't know. You said it's 4 hours away. Yeah, because we, you know, you have a host Rotary, which is a local one, and then you have an international one. And you're part of the international one, but we need to have a host club on the ground there.
Okay.
Okay.
So before I would present to a local club, I would probably need to have kind of the whole project laid out as far as who I would be working with on the project, like if it was vocational training, but I need to have
That
decide who would be doing the training. Would I have to have all those decisions made?
You need to have
present to a club.
You would need to have the community-based organization. You have your conversation with them, find out how much help they can provide. You might not need to have a vocational training team. They may have all of what you need.
Yeah.
And you know, that would keep it a lot simpler.
Yeah.
So anyway, we'll continue. We've talked back and forth, email, so we can continue to do that. Okay?
Okay.
That you're facing and kind of trying to bring awareness to all these different communities, you know, is it the fact that, like you said, you know, they're already kind of stuck on their ways? It's also the distance going to these different, you know, rural villages. I mean, what do you think is the biggest challenge for implementing all of these different initiatives?
Gentle way, just presenting their first reaction is actually spraying more. Okay. Then, so we don't want to create that disharmony here. So we're trying to bring the message out in different ways to raise awareness, I think, consciousness, so that they can relate the issues of cancer in their family and childhood issues, large stomach issues, and gastric stomach cancer is, as I mentioned, is the number one cause of death here, is relating what they're eating to the amount of residues of agrochemicals in the food supply. Those connections are called brain. So it's doing this as gently as possible. Then people are receptive once they've received the message and understand it, they have the awareness, then they're open to receive and start asking. Okay, so what do we do? What do we do? So, and it's not an overnight process.
Okay. And what can we do here? What can the members here in San Diego do?
Well, there's a lot to be done, actually, on your front. In the U.S., too, is supporting organic agriculture and the community-supported agriculture. Because ultimately, we just need to be the change, right? We want to see. So it's not that we could do anything to directly help at this moment, but actually through Rotary, there's a lot we can do as a group. But each of us, our own lives, just need to be the change and to consume organic food whenever possible.
Okay. One more question.
There's a woman who does a blog. She lives up in Spokane, and she does organic gardening. She does a blog, and she might be someone to connect with, because she might be interested in providing hints as to how to improve the growing. Her name is Susan Mulvihill. I'll try and send you an email about her. She was just on a KBPS program talking about this 5-acre land that she's now gardening with just natural methods. And she might be interesting to connect with, just because of her methods sound like what you want to foster in Costa Rica. You know, and if she
Thank
was
you.
Interested, she might be able to help you get the message out about Costa Rica on her blog.
Yeah. I'm happy to provide information about Costa Rica to raise awareness in the U.S. about what's happening here, but I realize that the same thing is happening in the U.S. So there needs to be greater awareness up north, too. And also having municipalities in the U.S. also declare a prohibition of use of agrochemicals in public spaces. This is not passed in most municipalities. Our country, the U.S. So there's a lot of work to be done wide on this, and realizing that it's no longer sustainable, this system of agricultural production. It's not supporting humanity in the highest way of evolving and growing. It's causing a lot of issues. I think 50 years later, we've seen that, you know, worldwide.
Okay, well, thank you so much, Amy. Everybody here is giving you a wave and a round of applause. Really appreciate it. Thank you again. Buenas noches.
Buenas noches. Thank you to all of you, and hope to see you in San Diego.
Sounds great. All right.
Yeah.
Bye.
Ciao.
Bye.
Ciao.
Stay dry.
You know what we tried? I mean, both are new to everything, but we've tried it before. I felt like last time the audio was so. Oh, sorry.